Bearing witness to crimes against humanity is one of the most important jobs of the journalist and the filmmaker. And there are few crimes in history that are more extreme than the Holocaust. But one of the most comprehensive cinematic records of the Nazi death machine was never shown in full until now. It was recorded by a specially commissioned Allied film unit entering the camps for the first time.
Through a loudspeaker in different languages, they said, "Be calm, be calm, be calm, stay where you are, be calm. Help is underway. We are the British soldiers. Help is underway." And people went just crazy.
That survivor kissing the hand of the British soldier who liberated the camp there in April 1945. And this compelling testimony is part of Night Will Fall, Andre Singer's documentary on how this footage was filmed and why it was shelved. He joined me in London earlier this week, along with the historian, Professor Rainer Schulze, who also worked on the project. Gentlemen, welcome. Let us go back to the beginning. This is such an extraordinary subject and such an extraordinary piece of work. Now we think of combat photographers as ordinary, being embedded as ordinary. What was the mission of this particular group of cinematographers?
They were filming battles as the troops went through towards Berlin, as you said, and then they came across the camps, and suddenly there was a different ball game at play here. They suddenly had thousands of corpses, death, destruction like nothing they'd seen during the war, and so they were told to stay. So this was particularly in Bergen-Belsen, where they were told, don't go on with the troops, stay there, record what you see. So they suddenly had something different to look at. Instead of distant military shots of battles going on, they suddenly had piles of dead bodies and things that they'd never ever, they just couldn't countenance, and were all pretty traumatized as a result.
So Rainer, as a historian, this was perhaps the first-hand evidence of the disaster of the Nazi experiment.
Absolutely, and that's exactly how they understood their task, to collect evidence of what the Nazis had actually committed. Obviously, the camps had been liberated, so they saw the results of the crimes, but it was important to record and document the results as closely and as detailed as possible so that the evidence was actually there and no one could come and say it didn't happen.
And yet, the idea was to broadcast it fairly quickly to show the German people at the time what had happened on their doorstep.
That was one of the tasks that film teams were set. The other task was actually to record it for any criminal proceedings.
And yet, Andre, this film was never shown.
Basically, it missed its time. Sidney Bernstein, who went on to found Granada Television, who was then in charge of propaganda filming for the Allies, was commissioned to make a film to show the German people, as you said, the crimes that had been committed. He gathered material from the Americans, the Soviets, British, put it together, and that film was meant to be sent to Germany. That was commissioned in April. May, the war ends. By June, the enemy who had been Germany became an ally. The ally who was working with the British, the Soviets, suddenly became the enemy. The whole political climate changed, and the British government in Germany and in London were saying, well, hang on a minute, this perhaps is the wrong moment to show this film, because we need the German people to be on side. They're suffering. We need to help them now rather than rub their noses in what had happened before. So the film was quietly shelved.
Until now.
Until now.
Let us play a clip, and then we can discuss, of the eyewitness of then-young British reporter Richard Dimbleby.
I find it hard to describe adequately the horrible things that I've seen and heard. But here, unadorned, are the facts. I passed through the barrier and found myself in the world of a nightmare. Dead bodies, some of them in decay, lay strewn about the road and along the rutted tracks. On each side of the road were brown wooden huts. There were faces at the windows, the bony, emaciated faces of starving women too weak to come outside, propping themselves against the glass to see the daylight before they died. and they were dying every hour and every minute.
It was so horrific that the BBC initially waited before they broadcast it because they had doubts whether my father had actually accurately described what he'd seen, and they checked and then put it out.
All those people sitting around that radio listening got a full and vivid picture of what it was all about. Rainer, do you think that in 1945, had this film been shown in Germany, it would have made a difference? It would have had an effect?
It's, of course, almost impossible to say, but my guess is that it probably would not have had much of an impact. You have to realize the German...
Really?
That's
something that horrific.
The reason being, and I was born in a city which was part of the American zone of the occupation right after the end of the war. So the American film about the camps was shown there. So my mother was actually sent in to see this film. And she said years later to me that actually when we got out there, we were horrified, obviously. But we didn't really think it had much to do with us. We didn't know about it. This was something that they just simply shut out and then didn't really want to get too close.
Didn't
to
want to get too close, because yeah. Many knew that this might have been going on. So absolutely. They didn't want to know what was being done in their name. And one of the quotes from the original films is, "Unless the world learns the lesson these pictures teach, night will fall," the title of the film, "but by God's grace, we who live will learn." Have we learned, or has night fallen?
I think the tragedy of the story, the tragedy of the film, is that I think in 1945, it was expected that we would learn. And it was hoped optimistically by Richard Crossman, who wrote that script, that by seeing these images, by understanding what had happened, this would never, ever happen again. It's that message we all hope to pass down to our children and our children's children. And now we look at the last 70 years, and you can count a whole host of genocides that are equally horrific that have gone on in other parts of the world and so on. And I suppose we have to admit that we haven't learned. We hope to learn, and we hope it would never happen again in that context, but sadly, I think the lesson hasn't been learned.
And Rainer?
I wouldn't be quite as pessimistic. We haven't learned in a way that this didn't happen again, but I think very important things have happened, and the UN Genocide Convention is one of these things. It is now an international crime. And those who perpetrate genocide know that they will be prosecuted.
Indeed, as we speak now, at The Hague, the leader of the Bosnian Serbs is about to hear the verdict after the massacre of Muslims at Srebrenica and other parts of Bosnia.
So I think that has actually changed. The impunity that was still almost
assumed. Taken for granted?
Yeah, that is gone. And yes, a lot of genocides have happened, and they were as horrific or similar to the Holocaust, but I think we have a different kind of attitude as an international community to these kinds. That might be a very, very small step, but I would argue it is actually an important step.
Andre Singer, Rainer Schulze, thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you.